This video is the ultimate guide to using Codable in Swift and SwiftUI. It offers a comprehensive hands-on approach to understanding data encoding and decoding in iOS development. It covers everything from the basics of mating your custom types conform to Codable to advanced techniques like handling nested data structures, error handling, and working with APIs. Additionally, the video demonstrates real-world applications of Codable with SwiftUI, showing you how to seamlessly integrate data models into user interfaces. With clear explanations and practical examples, this video is the go-to resource for mastering Codable in SwiftUI and Swift. Today we are going to talk about Codable, and we are going to cover like 90% of the use cases. But if you want to get to that expert level, go ahead and check out SwiftUI Camp. An 80% discount link is down in the description, because on week 2, we are going to talk about Codable, the extra stuff that did not make it into this tutorial. So I have created a demo project. It's basically a backend linked to Firebase. It has the app controller, fetching clients, adding clients, deleting clients, because my model is a client, as you can see. And on the content view, I'm just having a list, and I can fetch the clients, add a new client, and delete if needed. Okay, so if you want to take a look at the code, please pause the video. It's self-explanatory. Now, we are going to talk about Codable, and therefore we are going to be in this file a lot. So what are we going to cover today? We are going to talk about identifiable and how to handle that with SwiftUI and Codable. Adding a new property, deleting a property, you know, versioning, things change over time. Maybe giving default values if that is your preferred way of handling changes. And then having a nested model, because usually we don't want to have just one gigantic model with all of our properties. Now, what we are not going to cover, and I highly recommend that you check out SwiftUI Camp in the description, is changing value types, key types, and tucking all of this lot of code into a nice property wrapper. This is like the extra advanced level. So go ahead and check out SwiftUI Camp. Okay, so let me just build and run this project so you can see what we have currently. And we're going to tackle these issues one by one. We are first going to have this identifiable issue solved. So what we are having right over here is just a list of clients. We don't have any, so let's click on the plus. And there we go. We fetched that new clients. Let's take a look at the database. So let me just refresh this so we can see that added document. There it is, UUN. And the problem right over here, it might not be obvious, but we have this ID. This is for, again, the identifiable protocol. We should not clutter the database with this item. We should have the UID. That's fine. That's okay. That's a property. But we should not have the ID. So let's go back to Xcode and let's fix this. So what I'm going to do is copy this out and comment it out so you can see where we started off and where we are going to get to. And basically what I want to do is just not encode the ID, just the UID. So let's create our encoder. Firebase takes care of all of the encoding if we don't set up one. So what we are going to do is just, let's create first of all our coding keys. And as you can see, because we already have the UUID string on the ID, it's just suggesting the case of UID. That's perfectly fine with me. Now let's have the encoder. Let's have a little bit more space over here. Let's have the decoder in it from decoder. It's suggesting this is Xcode 16, by the way. It's really, really nice. So I'm going to hit tab again right over here. It looks really nice. But what if this UID will be missing at some point? This is when we are going to delete a property. So therefore, I'm not just going to decode this. I'm going to decode if present. And of course, I'm going to give it a default value. So we covered quite a lot with this one change. But yeah, that's what we want to have. Let's have the encode function. There we go. Encode the encoder, container, everything looks really nice. Also encode if present. That is what I want to change. Okay, that's fine. Now, in some cases, you also want to have kind of a default initializer for your model. So let's just have that. This is fine, but I just want to have this as optional, and let's set it to nil. Yeah, let's set it to nil. And then the default value would be that empty string right over here. Okay, so basically, that's it. Let's build and run and see what happens right now. Mastering SwiftUI is a fantastic opportunity because it streamlines the process of creating beautiful, responsive user interfaces for all Apple platforms with minimal effort. Its declarative syntax allows developers to build complex UIs more efficiently, speeding up app development while making it more enjoyable. Now, with SwiftUI Camp, you can learn SwiftUI in just 4 weeks through an intensive, hands-on course designed to get you building real-world projects quickly. Plus, with an 80% discount available in the video description, it's the ideal moment to invest in your skills and elevate your app development game. Basically, we should not see any changes. We should get back that object, UUN. That's fine. But now, when we are going to create a new one, let's create a new one. Let's click on the plus sign over here. As you can see, we added the 0RS. Let's go to our database, 0RS. Now, we are not having that ID saved. And also, when we are decoding this object, we are automatically adding the ID of the UUID strings. Therefore, it is identifiable. And we can add them into a for each view. Basically, that's the whole point of the identifiable. Great. So we covered quite a lot. Now, what if we want to add a new property? So let's add some sort of a date. Let's have a created. So var created. And this will be a timestamp. The timestamp comes from Firebase Firestore. It's all the way up there. So the default value, the initial value, I want to give it basically timestamp from a date dot now. Okay, that's great. Let's have the case for the coding key and then created. Let's just wait for it. Try container decode if present timestamp created. And yeah, that's perfectly fine. And then let's have another one. By the way, if you hit ask, it should kind of give you another AI generated suggestion. Let's see. This is not okay. So I will pause that. Try container. Let's see if it's good. There we go. It's not UID, it's just created. I'm just going to add that manually. Okay, so for the cre of created. And finally, let's have created with the timestamp of nil. That's fine. And then self dot created. Let's just wait for that. Created equals created. And the initial value, perfect. Okay, so now let's build and run. Well, before I build and run, let me just enable that on the view because we have this extra line added right over here. So created the date value. And now let's build and run. So what we are going to get is a new text, a new kind of line over here. And as you can see, it's just using now. So it's 10:13, it's just using now. What I'm going to do is just add a new one. So let's add a new one. We added that new one. This is 10:13, but it's not the same what we have over here. So let's just build and run one more time, and you will see that the first two, we are actually going to have 14 because it's just fetching the default value, which is great, which is okay for now. So, yeah, that's why you want to or you might not want to use default values. Next up, let's add the nested model. So So what I want to do is just add first and last name, but I don't want to have it as these properties right over here on the client. I want to create a separate struct for that. So let's create a model, struct name. It will be codable. And then it should have a first name. So let first, that's right. And last, that's great again. Coding keys are also fine. And let's have then the init decoder. Yes, they seem okay. But as I mentioned already, I prefer encode if present. So decode if present. Let me just copy that and paste that in there. And let's give default values. Okay, and now comes the encoder. So encode, that's right, not function but func, and let me just copy this out so I don't have to type all that much, and then first and last, and finally let's create our initializer. So init, this looks okay, really great. Let's have the default values, so equals nil. And then right over here, optional equals nil. And then let's give the default values. Great. So now my model is ready. So what I want to do is just use this right over here on the client. So var name, it will be of type name. And I'm going to give it the default value. So name. And with the default value. So first and last will be empty strings. So let's add the coding key, case, name, okay. And then name, try container, decode name for self. Well, again, decode if present is my preferred one. And the default value, again, will be name. There we go. Finally, let's add the encode if. So let's see if it's just going to suggest that. Encode if present name for name. Really great. And now let's have the name added right over there. It's suggesting the right thing. Really nice. It's learning, as you can see. And then self. Name equals name. Default value is name. Really, really nice. So for this to show up, I'm going to go to the content view and enable this one line. So let's build and run and see how this looks like currently. Build has succeeded. That's great. And as you can see, the default values, like the empty strings, have been added right over here. And again, default value for the timestamp for the first two. Now let's add a new one. We want to add the name too, so I will scroll down over here and let me just comment these in and the initial value commented out. Let's build and run once more, and then the name of Ada Lovelace will be added to the client. Let's build and run and see that. Okay, let's add that. And as you can see, now Ada Lovelace has been added with a Q7. And let's take a look at the database, because now we have the one with just the UID, no ID. Then we have created name and UID. And we have ID, the first one, UID. And finally, we have just created and UID. All of these four are different. And they are nicely accommodated into our list right over here. So our app is not crashing. Now, if you want to take it to the next level, if you want to learn how to actually handle when a value type is changed or a key type is changed, or you want to have all of this lot of code nested into a nice property wrapper, go ahead and check out SwiftUI Camp. We are going to cover all of these. An 80% discount link is in the description.